Good afternoon. I'll call this meeting of the Job Growth, Energy, Affordability, Policy, and Finance Committee to order. Today is Thursday, February 2nd. The first order of business is approval of the minutes from February 1st. Representative Clark moves approval of the minutes from February 1st. Are any corrections, additions, or changes? Seeing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, say nay. Motion prevails. The amendments are adopted. The minutes are adopted. Members, we have one bill on the agenda today. That's House File 600. The chair will move House File 600 be recommended to pass and refer to the Committee on Government Relations. Government Operations. And I hope they have good relations, too. There is a single author's amendment. Members, this is the amendment that conforms the research summary to what the bill is. That is the A99 amendment. The chair will move the A99
roll call, amendment. Mr. Chair.
A roll call has been requested on the A99 amendment. The clerk will take the roll.
Garofalo.
Yes.
Neuberger.
Aye.
Mahoney.
Aye.
Clark.
Yes.
Wagenius.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Barr.
Yes.
Baker.
Aye.
Davney.
Yes.
Fabian.
Yes.
Howe. Lehman.
Yes.
McQuaid.
Aye.
Metza.
Aye.
Moran.
Aye.
O'Neill.
Yes.
Rarick.
Yes.
Scott. Sundin.
Aye.
Thiessen?
Yes.
Vogel?
Yes.
West?
Yes.
There being 22 ayes and 0 nays, the amendment is adopted. Members, at this time, we're going to turn this over to Mr. Weeks from our nonpartisan staff. He'll do a review of the bill. I'll make a brief opening statement as the author of the bill. And then at that point, the proponents will come forward where they will have approximately 30 to 35 minutes. Mr. Todd Hill, Todd, can you raise your hand, please, so people see you? Todd will be managing the proponents' time for that first 30 to 35 minutes. At the completion of that, equal time will be given Brad Leto. Brad, can you raise your hand? Brad will be managing the time for the opponents. Again, for if the proponents do less than 30 minutes, then the opponents' time will be a minimum of 30 minutes, but it'll at least match up. It'll be fair. And then at that point, we will begin with those who signed testimony on those who signed up in advance. If you have not signed up in advance, Sam, can you please raise your hand? Why don't you stand up, Sam, so everyone can see you. Sam is our trustworthy committee page. He has the sign-up sheet. So you do have the sign-up sheet, don't you? Okay, good. So go ahead and maybe, Sam, if you want to walk to the back of the room so if people want to sign up, they can. You can get their name and information on the notebook, and we'll get them. We'll get to those. So with that, again, the chair made my motion. The bill's been amended. Mr. Weeks, to your presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members. Ben Weeks from the House Research Department. House File 600 prohibits local governments from adopting and enforcing certain types of labor regulations with regard to the private sector. Specifically, the bill would prohibit local governments from adopting or enforcing four types of regulations. The first is a minimum wage greater than the state's minimum wage. The second would be a requirement that a private employer provide any type of paid or unpaid leave. Third would be a regulation prescribing private employee work hours or scheduling. And fourth, a requirement that a private employer provide any types of particular benefits, terms of employment, or working conditions. In addition to those prescriptions, the bill specifically does not prohibit three activities and specifically excludes these from any preemption. And those are local governments setting their salaries, working condition, terms of employment, benefits for their own employees. Also, local governments agreeing to contract terms under which they require the other contracting party, even if it's a private employer, to provide certain wages, benefits, terms of employment to their employees. And finally, if a local unit of government provides financial assistance to a project and has a contract related to that financial assistance, that contract can also require that the beneficiary of the financial assistance provide certain wages, terms, conditions of employment. And the prohibition applies to local government policies retroactive back to January 1st of 2016. Under the A99 author's amendment, the bill also adds two appropriations unrelated to the substance. The first is $325,000 each year of the 2018-19 biennium to the Bureau of Mediation Services to fund the operations of the PER Board, the Public Employment Relations Board, which hears and decides public employer labor, unfair labor practice cases. In addition, a second appropriation would be $250,000 in 2018 and $500,000 in 2019 to the Department of Labor and Industry, specifically to their Labor Standards Division. And that would be in addition to any other money appropriated to the Department of Labor and Industry in the biennium, and the $500,000 figure would be added to the base going forward.
Thank you, Mr. Weeks. Appreciate the presentation. Members will make a brief statement, and then if Mr. Hill, if you want to have your testifiers start coming down or lining up. So members of the public and members of the committee, there are 854 cities in the state of Minnesota. It is unrealistic and unproductive to have 854 different labor policies across the state. For the past 100 years, it has been the experience of this state that we've had uniform labor standards. This bill does one thing and one thing only. It simply conforms the state of Minnesota to those standards. So with that, I'm happy to begin the testimony. Again, Mr. Hill will be managing the proponents. Mr. Alito will be managing the opponents. So Mr. Hill, if you want to have your first testifier come down. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. My name is Cam Winton. I'm with the Minnesota Chamber of Commerce. I bet you'd agree with me that it's been a difficult, unsettled time in our country and in our state. We see it in the newspaper every day. We see it when we talk to our spouses and our children. But I think it's important to remember in that unsettled and sometimes unsettling time that we are a united Minnesota. It might sound hokey, but it's a fact. We are a united Minnesota. We are neighbors. We're colleagues. We see each other in the hallways. Our children go to school together. We were all very cold this morning. A united Minnesota puts responsibilities on each of us. And the business community in Minnesota, the employers of Minnesota, take very seriously our responsibility to be an engine of the economy, to provide good jobs with good benefits to working people in Minnesota, to continue innovating and growing, competing in a global economy, offering goods and services into the market so that we all in our united Minnesota can thrive together. There is always room for improvement, but I submit for your consideration that the business community of Minnesota, the employers of Minnesota, are doing a pretty darn good job. Right now in Minnesota, there's a 3.9% unemployment rate. It's even lower in the Twin Cities. Right now, there is higher wage growth for workers than we've seen in 8 years, and that's good news. Every week, it feels like, employers are rolling out new benefits to address the needs of a changing workforce, and that's a good thing. But members of the committee, Minnesota's employers can only fulfill their responsibility if they have one uniform set of rules to play by. In contrast, it's very challenging, and it threatens the ability of Minnesota's employers to fulfill that responsibility if they have to play by a patchwork of regulations, if they have to play by a patchwork of rules across Minnesota's 854 cities and 87 counties. It is bad enough when at the state level, the state seeks to mandate that businesses provide very precise benefits. But it's even worse when cities do, because of the patchwork effect I just mentioned. Let me go into a little more detail. Imagine the complexity that a company has to contend with doing business across our interconnected state when, as it crosses each city line, it has to deal with it. It would have to deal with a new pay rate, have to keep track of a different set of hours, have to build a computer system to do that, have to hire a person to do that. It's mind-boggling, the complexity. Rather than spending time and resources innovating and offering new services and goods in the market, companies dealing with this patchwork would have to spend money on attorneys and HR professionals trying to comply. That's not the way to have a thriving Minnesota for everyone. A united Minnesota needs uniform laws. And that's why Minnesota's business community supports the Uniform State Labor Standards Act, which on three things, minimum wage, scheduling, and benefits, would make it explicit that the proper place for determining what mandates there will be is at the state level. In closing, let me say two things, Mr. Chair and the members of the committee. You'll hear tonight about local control. Local control is a tremendously important principle in our system of government. I'm preaching to the choir when I say this. And there are many areas of policy where local control is the overriding factor. For example, school curriculum, zoning, property tax assessment, where you put your traffic signs. But in contrast, as you all probably know better than I, there are many areas of policy where over the decades, the legislature has determined that we are a united Minnesota that should have a uniform standard. There is one criminal code in our state. There is one building code in our state. There is one consumer protection code and banking code and insurance code. This bill would merely make explicit that on the three areas I mentioned, those things are uniform across the state. Tonight, you'll hear from a wide variety of companies. If you have little kids like I do, it's gonna feel like Busy Town. Those Richard Scarry books. You're gonna hear from the butcher and the baker and the candlestick maker and the gas station and the bowling alley and the shopkeeper and the bank, et cetera, telling you why for their particular type of business, a patchwork is an impossibility and they need uniform standards. In closing, members of the committee, please allow Minnesota's employers to continue upholding their responsibility to our united Minnesota of providing great jobs with great competitive benefits. And please support the Uniform State Labor Standards Act.
Thank you. As we have, as the next testifier comes down, I have an announcement from the sergeant. The sergeant would ask that people standing, please fill in the seats that are open. That way that there is an opportunity for more people who are outside to be able to enter the room. Second of all, in the event that people are unable to enter the room, that we have room 181 set up for overflow seating. So again, if you are standing, you should take a seat.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Representative Boney.
I agree people should sit down. It's much more comfortable than standing. But as the testifiers go through their testimony, are we going to be allowed to ask questions, or are you going to ask that they all stay in the room so they can keep coming back down on a regular basis?
Representative Mahoney, especially in light of yesterday, we're going to be giving preference to public input versus member questions. So people have taken the time to come here, so we're going to focus on getting through the public input, then we'll move to member questions.
So, Mr. Chair, then
Representative Mahoney,
you would ask or recommend that most of the testifiers, as many as possible, stick around so that we can ask our questions of them to find out
that's entirely up to them, Representative Mahoney, but certainly if they want to answer questions from legislators, they should stick around, because if they leave, we can't.
If they leave, we get to talk about them?
We can still talk about them. Yeah, they can't answer the question. So. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, my name is Tony Chesick. I'm the Executive Director of the Minnesota Licensed Beverage Association, the MLBA. The MLBA is a statewide association of family-owned small businesses, liquor stores, bars, and restaurants. These bars and restaurants are places at their best, public houses, for all to gather, celebrate, relax, and create community. I'm here today with one of our members, Deepak Nath, who owns multiple establishments in Minneapolis. Deepak will describe with uncertainty the difficulties that he is currently facing in light of what Minneapolis has recently implemented and the various proposals that continue to threaten his investment in the city. I come today in support of House File 600. And to tell you how without this bill, there will be significant negative impacts to small businesses throughout the state. In the 159 years the state has existed, small business owners have been able to rely on wage and labor practices to be set at the state level. This has provided certainty and uniformity that is reliable. We haven't had to deal with the different labor rules city by city or township by township. The recent break from tradition is the first step in the creation of a patchwork of labor rules and potentially different levels of wages depending upon where a business is located. Next, some might think, what impact does this have on a bar, restaurant, or liquor store in your district? They think that their city would never do something crazy like these things are happening in cities across the state currently right now. I will tell you that if the cost of goods go up because distributor is based in a city that chooses to impose their own unique wage and labor standards, the cost will be passed on to the bar, liquor store, or restaurant in their city. We live in an integrated state where products are supplied from all parts of the state to all other parts of the state. I want to conclude where I began. The members of the MLBA are some of the most identifiable small businesses in your communities. We value our communities. We value our employees. We just think that setting wage and labor standards city by city does not make sense. Thank you.
Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, my name is Deepak Nath. I was born and raised in Minnesota, and I am also a husband and father of two beautiful girls, 3 and 4 years old. I am also a struggling small business owner, and most importantly, I'm a voter. And I feel under assault. People on both sides of the minimum wage issue like to use words like livable wage and the working man and what's fair. But I am also a working man. And I also have a family to provide for. Every day I wake up, I fight for my own family, and I fight for my work family. And I am currently under assault by the city of Minneapolis and the environment that they are creating for small business employers. I've invested incredible amounts of blood, sweat, and tears to build my own small piece of the American dream. The state already allows individual cities to impose taxes, and those have been turned into a weapon in the city of Minneapolis. The almost 17% total combined sales taxes that are crushing us today are already higher than New York, Miami, or even Los Angeles. This level of taxation makes it more expensive for our customers to visit and harder for us to provide an affordable experience. In spite of the vibrant city that we helped create, and in spite of the very high taxes that they have imposed, and instead of working to help small business, the city has engaged in what feels like an all-out attack on small business. Last year, the mayor and the city council proposed a very unpopular scheduling ordinance that would have only applied to those in the city of Minneapolis. Now, they backed off this, but this go-it-alone mentality still exists. And now they are actively talking about taking action on the minimum wage just for the city of Minneapolis. The state of Minnesota cannot and should not allow this to create a patchwork of wage laws that is not only detrimental to the small businesses who they represent, it hurts the whole state. Imagine you're a business on the city limits of Minneapolis and the competitor across the street is not under those ludicrous rules and taxes. Your prices will be 30% higher. You don't think customers will notice? Allowing any city to create wage laws like these is picking winners and losers. And that's not the role of government. You have a chance to do what is right and prevent this. Without your help, I believe that this will happen. Sure, I can try to raise prices, but my customers are already gravitating towards cities that aren't as expensive, and this could be the nail in the coffin. Thousands of people will lose their jobs, and many businesses will close. Remember, these are voters that are going to be hurt, and they won't forget this, and I won't forget this. I have leases I can't break and loans that I can't default on. I can't afford rogue actions like this. The city is trying to drive us out, and we're dispirited and beaten down. I beg you to pass this bill. Thank you.
Thank you. The next testifier, please come forward. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, good evening. I'm Jamie Poole, president of the Minnesota Grocers Association, and I'm here to speak in support of House File 600. The Minnesota Grocers Association is a state trade association representing the retail food industry. We are one of the oldest state trade associations, and we're celebrating our 120th anniversary of representing consumers, careers, and community. We have over 300 members with nearly 1,200 locations statewide. Our memberships include grocery, convenience stores, wholesalers, manufacturers, and anyone that supports the industry. Our member companies employ both union and non-union employees, and we provide about one out of every 20 jobs in this great state. We are very blessed in Minnesota with a unique culture of hundreds of grocers and convenience stores, many who are independent, generational, and locally owned. They are the cornerstones of the community. We are also the home to an abundant array of manufacturers, wholesalers, and distributors. They create jobs, support local charities, and provide a safe, responsible shopping experience. I want to provide a little insight into our industry. The average sale per customer transaction is around $31. Our average customer stops into one of our stores about 1.6 times a week, and the average family of four has a weekly shopping basket of about $145. The retail food industry typically operates on a net profit margin of around 1 to 1.5%. Additionally, the movement of food from farm to fork is a highly complex, interconnected framework of commerce involving all cities across the state. As industry strives to meet the needs of the 21st century consumer, consistency and predictability of marketplace is necessary. With the new trend of cities across the state enacting their own workplace mandates, creating a patchwork of compliance issue and complications will inevitably trickle through the entire food chain, increasing cost of goods. As an industry, we currently adhere to both federal and state labor laws. This third layer of labor regulation will put a significant hindrance on the success of our industry. As a community employer, we value our employees and know how important they are to the industry's day-to-day successes. We are a customer service industry, and the wellness, attitude, and relationships are key to our vitality. The grocery store is the heart of your community, and we strongly urge you to advance and support uniform state labor standards. Supporting this bipartisan legislation helps create a fair and level playing field and places the discussion of labor policies here at Minnesota's state legislature. Thank you, and I will be happy to stand for questions at the end.
Welcome to the committee, sir. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. My name is Steve Rush. I'm the Director of Government Relations for Holiday Companies. We are a privately held Bloomington-based convenience store company, and next year we will celebrate our 90th year of doing business. We have over 300 corporate and franchise convenience stores in Minnesota, located in approximately 160 cities and towns across the state. Holiday employs more than 4,200 people in Minnesota. I'm also an employment attorney for Holiday, and there are a number of concerns that my company and I have with the local employer mandates. First, we already have a great deal of complex legislation on the federal and state level regulating the employment relationship, particularly concerning employee leave. Adding a third local level only creates a confusing blend of laws. Second, compliance with some of the ordinances passed or contemplated is extremely difficult. For paid sick and safe leave, much concern has been expressed about counting the time an employee that is not based working in a city but occasionally spends times there. Holiday has petroleum drivers, bakery drivers, IT professionals, me, and other co-workers who spend intermittent amounts of time in various cities, and it's very difficult to accurately keep track of all that time. The scheduling proposal was equally burdensome, as it would have required 28 days notice of an employee's upcoming work schedule. It is literally impossible to accurately schedule retail convenience store employees that far out. If we make any change to the 28-day schedule, we would owe 1 hour of pay to the affected employee, or 4 hours of pay if we shorten or cancel a shift with less than 24 hours notice. The enforcement process would be very expensive for businesses. One of the paid sick and safe leave ordinances provides for a private cause of action and an award of attorney's fees to a successful plaintiff. It is inevitable that innocent mistakes will be made, and yet businesses will have to pay significant attorney's fees for those mistakes. Minnesota cities are also very active in regulating other aspects of our businesses by banning styrofoam cups, plastic bags, and legal tobacco products. Along with these expensive employment mandates, the cumulative effect of these regulations makes it more difficult to operate a successful business. I do not take lightly restricting cities and considering ways in which to improve local communities. However, there is significant potential that our cities will inadvertently create a bad business environment that will only ultimately harm the residents they seek to protect. Thank you very much for your time. I'll remain around for questions.
Thank you. Will the next testifier please come forward? Good afternoon. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. My name is Dave Reuter, and I'm the Vice President of Personnel for Thrifty White Pharmacy. We are a 100% employee-owned company. We've got 52 locations in Minnesota with about 1,400 employees. We're based in mostly community, county seat-type towns all across the state. I am here to testify in support of HF 600. It's encouraging to see that it's a bipartisan bill that was introduced, which would give Minnesota employers consistent laws to apply across all locations in the state. We have watched as local bills are passed or planned, as in Minneapolis, St. Paul, and Duluth. Many federal and state laws are already in place to provide employee benefit standards and employment rules. Local governments passing a third level of benefits and work rules that are not consistent from city to city make compliance almost impossible. In my experience, even the major human resources information systems don't have a way to manage city by city variations, especially when it comes to leave laws. We have employees that work in several different stores almost each and every week. As you can imagine, trying to pay employees different rates, provide paid leave with varying schedules, and have other minimum wage rules on top of that makes it really difficult to try to track all of that and try to apply that. The reality is that no law can really anticipate every real life situation, and allowing each local government to legislate employment law would be extremely difficult. Despite an employer's best efforts to comply with differing rules, errors will be made, or judgment calls will be interpreted differently, and the employer will face audits and penalties. If an employment issue is big enough to be legislated, it should be done at the state level so private employers can operate their business with one set of rules. Employee handbooks and policies and procedures just can't include all of the varying benefits and employment laws for every city where an employee-owned company like ours operates. At Thrifty White, we pride ourselves on the decisions we make relating to the benefits we provide, and we are concerned that a patchwork of local labor laws will really take a step backwards for us. Thank you for the opportunity to provide this perspective.
Thank you. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. My name is Brian Carr. I'm the Government Relations Director and legal counsel at the Minnesota Retailers Association. It is my great honor to represent retailers across this state, from small Main Street businesses to medium-sized retailers with multiple locations to national retailers. Retailers across Minnesota have expressed concern over the patchwork network of local ordinances that have passed recently and are being considered. Small Main Street and medium-sized retailers in particular say they will be greatly impacted by the new significant increase in their administrative duty to comply with local labor ordinances. In addition to already complying with state and federal law, Minnesota's retailers will now be required to devote even more resources into complying with local law, which we have already seen lacks consistency among cities that have passed. The extrapolation of these inconsistent ordinances, as we've already heard, could lead to 854 different ordinances across 87 counties, or potentially 87 different county ordinances, all of which Minnesota retailers who are already operating in an internationally competitive environment would have to comply with. even if it is not 854 ordinances. Imagine trying to deal with just a fraction of that. It would be extremely difficult. Retailers across Minnesota appreciate consistent, predictable, and uniform labor standards as they allow retailers to do what they do best: invest in their communities, invest in their employees, and sell great products to consumers at competitive prices, as opposed to losing growth opportunities to another layer of compliance. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity to testify today.
Thank you. Would the next testifier please come forward? Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Tim Doherty, and I'm speaking here today on behalf of my company, Doherty Staffing, and also the hundreds of staffing firms located throughout the state that are represented by our trade group, Minnesota Recruiting and Staffing Association. Many staffing firms have multiple office locations, and in my company's case, we have 26 offices located throughout the state of Minnesota. The staffing industry in Minnesota hires over 60,000 employees each week in our state alone. These employees are on our payroll each day and work at the thousands of our client companies located throughout the entire state. We provide to these employees all of the mandated federal and state required pay and benefits any employer in Minnesota is required to provide. In many cases, staffing companies also provide benefits like paid time off, sick time, and health benefits. The one major difference for a company like Doherty Staffing compared to Medtronic, U.S. Bank, or Cargill is that 1 week, our employee will be working for one of our clients in St. Paul. The next week, that same employee may move to one of our clients that is located in Minneapolis. And the following week, they take a new assignment with our client located in Bloomington. It's also possible and happens frequently that the employee may choose to work for a competitor after ending an assignment with one staffing firm and may not return for several weeks or months. The support for this bill by the entire staffing industry is unanimous because, as you can see, trying to comply with different minimum wage rates, leave time, scheduling of work time, or a particular employee benefit that can vary by each city would create major challenges in managing and maintaining compliance with each separate local government. If, say, not only Minneapolis and St. Paul set up their own requirements for workers that, as of today, do have different criteria, but soon Edina, Burnsville, St. Cloud, and Rochester develop their own workplace requirements that are all slightly different, trying to maintain compliance for each different city would become a major burden for our industry. Accordingly, we all ask that you please vote in favor of the Uniform State Labor Standards Act. Thank you for allowing my time today.
Thank you, Mr. Doherty. The next testifier, please come forward. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record, sir.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chairman, committee members. My name is Tim Warkey. I'm the Chief Executive Officer of the Associated General Contractors of Minnesota, and AGC is the oldest and largest construction trade association in the state. We represent over 400 commercial building, highway, specialty, and affiliate contractor members across the state. About 80% of our member firms are union-affiliated signatory contractors, and I wanted to point out that construction employs somewhere between 50 and 60,000 persons in the state and makes up about 4 to 6% of the state GDP. AGC is supportive of the Uniform State Labor Standards Act because we believe a patchwork of local ordinances that define employment benefits and conditions across the state is inherently unworkable for the construction industry. Construction businesses and construction employment, I submit, are unique and distinctly different from other industries. For example, the workforce. Construction workforce is a transient workforce. The craft workers regularly move from project to project, employer to employer, and city to city. It's not uncommon for a construction worker to have worked multiple projects for multiple employers in just one construction season. And tracking the variable hours worked in differing benefit terms and conditions across political jurisdictions would be burdensome, costly, and unworkable for construction employers. Secondly, construction is largely in this state a collectively bargained situation. In the union construction model, wage and benefit packages are collectively bargained between employers and the trade representatives. In 2014, construction worker pay averaged $58,000, or 13% more than private comparable industries. Collectively bargained construction contracts already have an accommodation for sick leave and PTO. It's called a vacation savings fund. The vacation savings fund is a mechanism that allows the worker to bank a portion of their hourly pay that can then be accessed to compensate that employee for PTO or sick time off. Lastly, construction employers are small businesses. Over 90% of our contractors employ fewer than 20 persons. And most of those employees are field craft workers. There are no HR professionals, no benefits managers to track and accommodate a patchwork of local benefit ordinances. We feel that if each municipality is allowed to enact their own unique wage and benefit ordinances, the logical market response will be the loss of competition as contractors choose which projects to bid in avoidance of the compliance burdens these ordinances might impose. Additionally, the cost of construction services may also rise in response to the added compliance burden. We urge you to support this important piece of legislation. We believe the state must intervene in this matter and pass this legislation to prevent the implementation of burdensome and unnecessary compliance standards on industries like construction that already meet the desired outcomes of such ordinances and provide strong collectively bargained wage and benefit packages for their workforce. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. I am John Hausladen, president of the Minnesota Trucking Association. We are a statewide organization representing 675 motor carriers and their allied vendors. I'm here today to testify in support of House File 600, a bill that fosters uniform labor standards and helps trucking companies by ensuring a consistent marketplace, a level playing field across the state, and a stable work environment for our workforce. Trucking companies will be negatively impacted if they are required to adhere to a patchwork of local labor and employment ordinances. Truck drivers are constantly on the move, loading, unloading, and driving from customer to customer. As an example, a driver could start his day in Blaine, deliver in Moundsview, Roseville, St. Anthony, Minneapolis, St. Paul, North St. Paul, before returning to Blaine all in the same day. Now imagine what it would be like for a trucking company to track that driver's hours and activities and then ensure he receives the right benefits according to each city's ordinance. It would truly be a bookkeeping and compliance nightmare. We believe a better solution would be to have consistent uniform labor standards between jurisdictions, which is why we support House File 600. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. Hill, we are at 31 minutes, so this will be your last testifier before we go to those with concerns of the bill. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
My name is Doug Sams. I'm a longtime deli restaurant owner, D. Brian's Deli and Catering, Greenfield Natural Kitchen. I have locations in four different cities in the Twin Cities, and we're looking at the complexity of trying to follow the rules and what a challenge that would be for my business. We're a small business. We have 100 employees, but only three people that work in the business office that track it, and one individual in particular that runs all of the HR and the benefits. And we are, she's looking at the complexity of this and trying to understand how we can keep track of it. Because I have different restaurants in different municipalities, a lot of my employees at the different locations, they know one another. They're all friends. And the idea that some of their peers and their different job levels would have a different set of benefits for scheduling or for pay or for hours or for earned sick and safe leave. It's very challenging in our organization. We consider our employees family members. We have a lot of, even the food business, a lot of longtime employees, average tenure is over 3 years. It's a terrific group of people. I love and respect my employees, and I'm looking at this as a challenge for me emotionally to keep my family together and without causing the discourse. In a practical nature, all of our web and our, we have one website for all of our locations. We have one menu for all of our locations. And the impractical nature of it is we post prices on our website. And now we would have to go to, we expect with the different coming burdens of the added compensation that we would have to have different prices in all of our different locations. And that's another challenge for the website, for the communication, for the talking about why does this product cost more in there, if they can even get to the website to understand why the cost of labor is in different organizations. And so I believe in the one state, one rule approach to this. I think that that's the best way for my employees, my 100 employees, for my customers, to be able to run the business efficiently.
Mr. McElroy, did you wish to introduce yourself and offer very brief testimony?
Mr. Chairman, members, my name is Dan McElroy. I'm Executive Vice President of the Minnesota Restaurant Association and the Minnesota Lodging Association. Our members share the concerns that Doug expressed, concerned about having to deal with multiple sets of rules in various jurisdictions. Think about how portable some aspects of food service are today. We have members who operate food trucks that may have those food trucks in one location in a different municipality virtually every day of the week. Many of our members have catering operations where they will cater weddings and birthday parties and bar mitzvahs and company parties and a variety of other things in different locations every day of the week. Some do have bricks and mortar. Some, like Dove, have multiple locations. We're very concerned about the practical aspects of having multiple rule books within the state of Minnesota. And we support House File 600. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thank you for each of those testifiers. And again, we're going to give time now for those with concerns for the bill. At the completion of this testimony of those with concerns, then we will go back to taking public testimony, and it'll just be kind of back and forth. So if there are people who did not get a chance to testify during the proponents or those who have concerns time frame, there will be limited public testimony after that. Welcome to the committee, and I'm looking for a signal from Mr. Lado, so like you can tell me that the right person is down here. Because I was thinking before, what if somebody just got up and walked down? Who would stop them? So I'll look to you for the thumbs up or the thumbs down, but you got the thumbs up. Welcome to the committee. Please state your...
Well, that's not me. Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman and members of the committee. My name is Arlene Datu, and I am a leader with Isaiah and a mother of three adult children who are all college-educated and living in St. Paul. I was jubilant when the St. Paul City Council voted unanimously on a sick and safe time ordinance for our city. The same thing happened in Minneapolis, and that also made me jubilant. I and many of my colleagues in Isaiah had worked long and hard with our city council and our community to make sure that we could get earned sick and safe time for all workers, and including Minneapolis and St. Paul, that amounts to 150,000 workers who do without paid sick time. That includes my son, my daughter, and my daughter-in-law. But now it appears that these corporate special interests are trying to undo all the good we have done for our city and the people in our community with the introduction of this House File 600, and it would nullify the paid sick time that is so important to so many people. My children and my grandchild will suffer if this bill is allowed to move forward. Two of them hold down jobs here in the city where they receive no benefits, including no paid sick time. My daughter works at a restaurant here in St. Paul and has had to go to work sick because she needs the money to pay her rent, utilities, and groceries. She can't afford to miss any hours. My daughter-in-law works in St. Paul and gave birth to a baby boy last year. She had to take her son, my grandson, to the emergency room for care one evening when he was running a high temperature and continuously vomiting, only because she couldn't take time off during the day to take him to a doctor. That is not right. And indeed, it doesn't sound to me like this is a united Minnesota if there are 150,000 people who have to go through these same similar experiences. Good, hardworking people should be able to stay home when they are sick or have a medical issue and not have to worry about if they will have the money to pay their bills. As a person of faith, I believe we all need to be treated with dignity and respect, as we are all made in God's image and likeness. There's no sense of dignity or respect toward us as human beings when a person has to drag himself or herself to work or send a child to school sick because they have no other recourse. That is an untenable choice. I urge this committee to oppose statewide preemption of local workplace standards. And the powerful corporate interests are attempting to interfere with the democratic process, to strip local residents of basic workplace protections, and to restrict existing powers of local governments. I urge you to choose instead for families and local communities and local public officials who can make the best decisions about the welfare of our communities and not the large corporate interests whose focus is solely profits and the bottom line. Choose for the good of all our families and our children by not letting this bill go forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Members of the public, this is a reminder. This is a committee hearing of the Minnesota House of Representatives. It's not a Donald Trump rally. If you have opinions, certainly we want to hear them. Please conduct yourself as if though you are at a committee hearing. Thank you. Mr. Fredo, so this is, Mr. Lato, I'm apologies. My clock shows we'll be at about 5:40. That'll be the curfew time. So welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and committee members. My name is Daniel Swenson Klatt. I'm a resident of Minneapolis and a small business owner. For the past 11 years, I've operated an independent neighborhood cafe seeking to be an employer who meets the highest standards for his employees, for his community, and for the earth. I've been ahead of the ordinances for organics composting and packaging because I believed it was the right thing to do. I implemented higher minimum wages and earned sick and safe time before they became required because it was the right thing to do. What I hear, sadly, is employers who are seeking the lowest possible standards. Our state needs to set standards, and we've been here before to ask for higher standards. I've been an active voice in my neighborhood's efforts to improve its community. I've been an active voice in my city, and I've been before you too. It's good for my business to be involved in decisions that affect the business climate and my community, and my city and my state. It's not good for my business that I have to argue against paid lobbyists or big corporations so that my voice can be heard. I participated deeply in the efforts to bring earned sick and safe time to Minneapolis as a good investment in the business and in my employees. I was listened to. I was negotiated with. I was brought into the decision-making process. I participated in hearings and listening sessions. I had a voice that was important, indeed, even I think more important than the voices of big lobbyists and corporations. I'm not being paid to be here. I actually am paying a staff person to watch the shop so that I could be here today. It's actually not in my business interest to leave my shop, but I'm here. I've also met and developed relationships with business owners in Grand Marais, another fine little town that I love dearly. And I know my issues in Minneapolis are far different than the ones the Grand Marais business owners face. They share their challenges of dealing with seasonal housing and labor, with transportation and transit. They need the opportunity to craft ordinances that fit their business and their community, even though they might be different than mine in Minneapolis. I need the opportunity to speak up for myself and my business at the level where it really matters. please oppose this bill. Don't take away my voice and turn it over to the big corporations and the folks who can spend the time at the state level. This really isn't good for small businesses. I have enough challenges, yes, and I'd like to stay in direct contact with my own elected officials. They're the ones who come to my shop. They live in my block. I see them in the places where I go to shop. I can have contact with them daily. I know how to get to their office pretty easily. It's really hard for me to get here. But I came here today because I believe we need this bill to be set back.
Thank you very much for your testimony. The next testifier, please come forward. Welcome to the committee, sir. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. My name is Bill McCarthy. I'm president of the Minnesota AFL-CIO Federation, representing more than 1,000 unions and 300,000 working Minnesotans. I'm here today to speak in opposition to House File 600. The committee has a clear choice today that will impact local communities, local families, and all working Minnesotans. A vote to advance this bill is a vote to deny paid sick days to more than 150,000 working Minnesotans. It's a vote that tells thousands of citizens who lobby their local elected officials that their voice doesn't matter. It tells citizens that local democracy doesn't matter. And it's a vote that tells local elected officials, small business owners, and working people across our state that they aren't allowed to improve labor standards to improve their communities. Mr. Chair, committee members, make no mistake. This bill is part of a national corporate-backed effort to undermine local democracy. You may have heard of the American Legislative Exchange Council, ALEC. Their website has at least three model bills preempting labor standards, perhaps more. We should defend local communities and local authority. Sadly, this bill does the exact opposite. House File 600 is bad for communities, bad for small businesses, and bad for working families. I strongly urge you to vote no on this bill. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony, Mr. McCarthy. Will the next testifier please come forward? Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Chair Garofalo, members, my name is Tom Marver, and I'm a board member of JCA. Jewish Community Action's mission is to bring together Jewish people from diverse traditions and perspectives to promote understanding and take action on racial and economic justice issues in Minnesota. Founded in 1995, Jewish Community Action organizes Jewish Minnesotans to act together for social change. With a unique model that combines traditional congressional-based community organizing with issue-based campaign work, we engaged our community and bring a distinctly Jewish voice to the fight for justice. This preemption bill is an attack on workers who have recently made progress at the local level. JCA opposes the passage of House File 600. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Would the next testifier please come forward? Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Good evening, Mr. Chair and members of the committee. My name is Lisa Bender. I'm a member of the Minneapolis City Council, and I appreciate the opportunity to come tonight and offer testimony on behalf of the City of Minneapolis. I'll note that Councilmember Alondra Cano is here as well, and Councilmember Jacob Fry was here earlier but had to leave. As elected officials, you know that we are all entrusted with making decisions on behalf of our constituents. At the local level, we are often the front lines for our constituents for issues big and small. From streetlights to public health and public safety, to helping small businesses open their doors, and increasingly to answering calls about housing costs, evictions, and other symptoms of poverty, our constituents depend on us. This morning I dropped off my oldest daughter at kindergarten, and I told her I was coming here to the Capitol tonight to ask state lawmakers not to block our city's ability to make laws like the earned sick and safe time that I helped pass last year. My daughter goes to school in a district where 8% of children experienced homelessness last year, and more than 60% of our kids qualify for free and reduced lunch. As a mom, I know that parents are doing everything they can to care for their kids, and that our hardworking parents need workplace protections that reflect the realities of today's economy, where so many rely on multiple low-wage jobs to meet basic needs. I'm not willing to accept a reality where children have to go to school hungry, and I know that you agree. We understand that the stated purpose for a bill like HF 600 is to avoid what has been described as a patchwork of policies related to wages and benefits and time off. The city of Minneapolis supports a statewide approach to these issues, including an increase in the state minimum wage, paid sick and safe time, paid family and medical leave, as well as other policies that promote health, safety, and equity in the workplace. But in absence of moving at the state level, and in response to overwhelming demand from our constituents, the City Council and Mayor of Minneapolis enacted an ordinance last year to ensure that our workers in the city have access to paid, safe, and sick time. The law was crafted, as you've heard, with significant input from small business owners, large employers, employees, business and labor representatives, and many of our constituents. During the process, we heard story after story of hardworking people who've had to choose between going to work sick, endangering the health and well-being of the public and their coworkers, or losing an important paycheck. Our paid safe and sick time law addresses the very real situation of families in our community for whom one or two days of paid missed pay means the difference between being able to pay rent or not. In our city and across the state, many employers already provide paid time off to workers, we know this, to address their health and medical needs. But our ordinance gives us protection to over 140,000 workers in our city, which is approximately 41% of our workforce that did not have access to paid sick time. Many of these workers are in service jobs that increase the risk of spreading contagious illness within our city, looking at research authored by our Minnesota Department of Health. So to conclude, we ask as a city that you not stand in the way of us meeting the needs of our residents. So we respectfully oppose HF 600. Our communities across the state are not uniform. This proposed law obstructs local government's ability to respond to local concerns. It bypasses the views of residents on issues that impact them in their communities and undermines our ability as a local government to respond to needed changes expressed by our constituents. Thank you again.
Thank you, Councilmember Bender. Will the next testifier please come forward? Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
I'm Todd Mickelson. I'm a small business owner in Orono, Minnesota. And as a small business owner, I can't afford to hire a professional lobbyist to speak for me on public issues. It's difficult for me to even find when policies that would affect my business are being considered at the Capitol. So I'm glad to be here to state my concerns about big business lobbyists interfering in our local democratic process. When we elect our city council members, we expect and hope that they will do our bidding. Since they are the most local elected officials, we have the most intimate relationship with them of all elected officials, and that's where our voice begins. To have our voice then be stifled by having those city elected officials' policies be rendered invalid is a direct affront to us. It's easier for small business owners to be in contact with our city officials, and in fact, small business owners often work with city officials to adjust laws and ordinances to become the best fit for our local areas. It's these adjustments that often end up shaping state and national policies to be better as well. The work we as small business owners do along with our city officials should not be disqualified. It should be embraced and learned from. And to take away our local control of things is nothing other than an intrusion. Large corporations often get benefits that us small business owners have no access to. We're left out of the equation because we have no one to speak for us at the state capitol or in DC. Only the large corporations who can afford to hire lobbyists are accommodated. So I hope you will take the opportunity to hear my voice as a small business owner asking you to please not take away my voice at the city level. City councils are listening to us constantly. We have much easier access to them, and they are our neighbors. To stifle them is to stifle us. So I'm asking you to please oppose this bill. Please not stifle the voice of small business owners like me. allow us to retain our local control of our own fates. Large corporate lobbyists do not speak for me. I do. And I hope you'll recognize me and other small business owners as well. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for your testimony. Will the next testifier please come forward? Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
My name is Steve Delzer. I serve as the Bishop of the Southeastern Minnesota Synod of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. Our office is in Rochester, and I live in Faribault. Chairman Garofalo, I am concerned about the preemption bill, HF 600, that you are considering in your committee this week. As Lutherans, we have a long tradition of engaging in public discourse and decision-making in our communities as we endeavor to make them work better for everyone. HF 600 strips our local communities and our local congregations from participation in the shaping of their own communities. House File 600 takes away local control over such basic things as wages and earned sick time. Just this past year, St. Paul and Minneapolis passed earned sick and safe time ordinances that gives the ability to 150,000 people to take a paid sick day. That's something we all need and want, and it's something that the populations and the elected officials in St. Paul and Minneapolis voted locally to do. Many Lutherans are located in Greater Minnesota. Taking away control and moving these decisions only to the capital in St. Paul does not reflect the history of this state or the sensibilities of the people in our congregations. Many of our people feel strongly that the best government is a government that's local and closest to its people. For many Minnesotans, that's not always in St. Paul. This bill may only increase the sense that many in Greater Minnesota have that decisions about their lives and their communities are being made hundreds of miles away. I'm asking you to not pass the bill, HF 600, through this committee. Thank you.
Thank you. The next testifier, please come forward. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record.
My name is Kedro Ali. I live St. Paul. I work the St. Paul. We needed the sick pay and sick time because the sick time is very important. If we are parents, our children, they get sick because we are a human being. So we need the sick time because it's very important. If we are missing one day, my job, I'm missing my job. Because if I stay, my children, they get sick. Maybe they sick the 2 days or 3 days. If I miss my job, 3 days, I miss my check pay. So please don't take away the sick time. Please and please. We need it because only we eating the day is the work. Because we don't save any money, our account, only we see the day we work. Please and please, we need the sick time. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your question. Members of the audience, if you wish to offer immediate response, room 181 is available for overflow seating, and you can offer your response at that time. Please conduct yourself as if though you are in a Minnesota House of Representatives committee hearing. Mr. Lito, the next testifier, please. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record.
Thank you. Good evening. Mr. Chair and members of the committee, my name is Rose Roach. I am the executive director of the Minnesota Nurses Association, a position I've been proud to hold for the past 2 years, representing 20,000 nurses across Minnesota. I come before you today in opposition of HF 600, and I believe I can lend to you not only the position of our nurses, but also some personal experience to shed light on this issue. Last year, I was privileged to serve as co-chair of the Citizens Citizens Task Force to recommend components for an earned safe and sick time policy for the city of St. Paul. The committee was diverse, and it included business owners, labor leaders, community advocates, and industry experts. One of my co-chairs was, in fact, the president of the St. Paul Chamber of Commerce. During the 10 weeks that we convened, we heard from St. Paul City residents, from business owners large and small, from employees, community members, and union representatives. The discussion over such policy was robust and at times challenging, but in the end, we came up with a workable policy full of recommendations that the vast majority of task force members, including some business owners, agreed to send forward. Those recommendations provided the foundation for what became the Earned Safe and Sick Time Ordinance, subsequently passed unanimously by the St. Paul City Council. Mr. Chair and members of the committee, this is exactly the example of local control and initiative that state legislators should not only support but should applaud. It was democracy in its purest sense. A diverse set of stakeholders met to improve our local community and recommend a solution to our city leaders to create a community strengthening compromise through local control. Having spent 27 years negotiating labor contracts, we often say a good deal is when everyone walks away a little unhappy. It now appears, however, that outside corporate interests are intent on doing an end run around the will of the people. Rather than exercise patience to see if the local ordinances are working, those few outside corporate interests would rather bring their grousing to you. What this does, however, is take the local control from local communities and their citizens who care the most about where they live and work. I urge you to consider this very carefully, because when local residents feel powerless to improve their local communities, they will begin to disengage. If legislators make the state capitol the only place where local citizens can improve the lives and livelihoods of their fellow citizens, I ask then, what is the role of local government? Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the committee, for allowing me this opportunity to testify.
Thank you very much for your testimony. The next testifier, please come forward. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Hi, my name is Katie Drejos. I'm here representing NOC, and I am a retail worker for the last 8 years. I'd like to start off by saying that the sentiments from the opposition are nice. I'm glad that you say that you care for your employees and that you have their best interest in heart, but in my experience as someone who works in the retail sector and works for a large corporation, I would be extremely naive to believe that I matter. My whole working life, I have been a number and an easily replaceable number. I have absolutely no say in my future, and I have to take a pay cut in order to move up in my industry. I am not given any paid sick time or safe time. And although I was hired at 36 hours, my hours have been cut to 29 with as little as 1 day notice, and 2 weeks before Christmas at that, which was really fun. I have no say in the corporate world. I can't do anything about it. My only saving grace is that I am able to lobby for my interests at a city level. The cities actually know me. I can go and talk to these people. This House File 600 is a direct attack on the working class and an attempt to make government even less inaccessible. How can you deny every small town in Minnesota the right to lobby for their specific interests? You can't tell me that my interests here in Minneapolis and Brainerd are the same. I'm lucky to live 10 minutes from the Capitol, but other people who live 2 to 3 to 4 hours away, how are their voices supposed to be heard on workers' rights? I would urge those who support this bill to try to see the world through a different perspective and learn empathy and understand that I will no longer be a number, and the rest of the working class also will no longer be just a number, and do not pass House File 600. My future depends on it.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Would the next testifier please come forward? And did someone leave their glasses down here at the testifier's table? Right up here on the ledge. No? Okay. Please proceed with your testimony. State your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. I'm Julie Blyle, Legislative Director for AFSCME Council 5. House File 600 prohibits local units of government from increasing the minimum wage above the state minimum wage, as evidenced in lines 1.15 through 1.18. House File 600 also expressly disallows local governments from adopting other measures that would benefit workers in terms of paid family leave and other benefits. This is wrong for Minnesota. Local governments have the best knowledge of what their localities are able to provide to their residents, and in regards to the minimum wage, paid family leave, and medical leave, and other benefits. If local governments want to institute policies regarding these benefits, they should be allowed to do so. If they do not wish to expand upon current benefits or institute new benefits, they do not have to. Local governments ought to have control over what policies they want in their localities. AFSCME Council 5 is strongly dedicated to ensuring all Minnesotans have access to a good quality of life and dignity in both the workplace and at home. And to accomplish this, all Minnesotans have the right to earn a good living and be provided the benefits that they have earned. AFSCME Council 5 stands strongly opposed to House File 600. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Would the next testifier please come forward? Good evening. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
My name is Guillermo Lindsay, and I'm a member of Satool. What I have to say is this is a corporate-driven attack on cities and working people that will have real-life consequences. Over 150,000 families in Minneapolis and St. Paul will see earned sick time taken away, forces them back into the situation where they have to choose between a paycheck or the health of their families. I was one of those low-wage workers on the Minneapolis Workplace Partnership Group, the committee that worked on and developed the paid sick days policy accommodation for the city. This will harm local cities and countries across the state by interfering with their ability to build on the state minimum standards to do what is best for their families and our communities. It is a power grab by corporations and a threat to our local democracy. So what I'm saying to you is, do you want us to choose between a paycheck or to take the time to take care of our children? Put yourself in my shoes. I have a six-year-old son, and he's at home sick right now. So you're telling me if you take away the sick time policy, I won't be able to take my son to the doctors? It's a shame, and I urge you guys not to do so. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Would the next testifier please come forward? Good evening, welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, my name is Deanna Sandy. And I'm one of the owners of St. Agnes Baking Company right here in St. Paul, stone's throw from the Capitol. I support earned sick and safe time because we value our employees and we are proud of the beautiful and healthy bread that they bake. When an employee is sick, they cannot work in the food industry. It's a food and drug administrative law. That is why when our employees are sick, they can go home and have paid time off. I believe that all employees across the state should have earned sick and safe time under a policy at least as strong as those of the Twin Cities. Until that is made a state law, it is critical not to preempt the Minneapolis and St. Paul ordinances and not to take us earn sick and safe time away from more than 150,000 Minnesotans who have finally won these benefits. All employees, all participants in our democracy, and all families deserve to be treated with dignity. That is why I oppose preemption and urge you to do the same.
Thank you for your testimony. Would the next testifier please come forward? Good evening, welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
My name is Alexis Collins, and I'm a fast food worker. I live in North Minneapolis. I've been working at Burger King for 6 years, since I was 14 years old. I'm a member of the tool because working people in the community of color deserves an actual life and not just to survive. I've been fighting for minimum wage increase and more benefits so we could take care of ourselves and provide for our family with dignity. I protested and gone on strike because I believe our voice matters and we can change when we come together. This bill is a corporate attack on people that will have real life consequences. I am 8.5 months pregnant now with my first child. We won sick days in the city of Minneapolis, and I was counting on that to benefit when I go back to work with a young baby. If this bill passed, we will be back at square one, forced to make decisions between paychecks and our family's health and my baby's health if she gets sick. When I'm only making $9.75, that's a big difference in the life, and it takes care of what I need to. Please don't strip us of everything that we worked hard so we can get. We should support local communities and are just doing what's best for our family, not to take local control and move families back like mine. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Will the next testifier please come forward? Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Mr. Chair, members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. My name is Javen Swanson. I'm one of the pastors at Gloria Day Lutheran Church in St. Paul. I'm also a clergy leader with Isaiah. You'll have to excuse my raspy voice. I'm recovering from a cold. I actually took a sick day earlier this week so I could rest and keep my coworkers safe. I'm lucky to have access to paid sick time, but in St. Paul, there are currently 72,000 workers who don't. Fortunately, this past year, the city of St. Paul passed an earned sick and safe time ordinance that is slated to go into effect this summer. The process was a triumph of local democracy. Many St. Paul congregations, including my own, invited their city council members to public meetings where they heard real people's stories. Hundreds of St. Paul residents attended and testified at multiple city council hearings. The city council had lengthy discussions and ultimately, by a unanimous vote, established an ordinance that serves the needs of our local community. On the night of the vote, one council member remarked that she had never seen so many citizens engaged in the political process. This bill is an attempt on the part of big corporate interests to shut down local democracy. We see what's going on here. Businesses don't want to expand worker benefits or increase wages, and with vast resources and an army of lobbyists in Washington and here in St. Paul, they usually get their way. So when local communities do what's right for our most vulnerable neighbors, it's not surprising that powerful business lobbies try to shut down local democracy too. It's not surprising, but it is reprehensible. Proponents of this bill say that preemption is about creating a consistent standard across Minnesota, avoiding a patchwork of regulations. I'm happy to call their bluff. If one state, one rule is really what they seek, great. Let's use St. Paul's sick time ordinance as a model for statewide legislation that protects the most vulnerable members of our communities, those whom Jesus called the least of those among us. I respectfully call upon the legislature to exercise moral leadership. Stop this attack on local democracy, or if you are serious about one state, one rule, pass earned sick and safe time for all Minnesotans. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Will the next testifier please come forward? Or actually, there's one more testifier. We're at the time right now, but we'll get one more in. Good evening. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Hello, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. My name is Gay Sorensen. I'm a member of Isaiah, one of the groups that worked almost 2 years to get the ordinance passed in St. Paul. And I care very much about protecting the ordinance for earned sick and safe time because of my adult son and all the other low-wage workers that we've been taking advantage of for so long. My son has worked at a large retail store for over 5 years and has never had paid sick days. He tries not to miss work when he's sick because he'll lose pay or he could get in trouble with the store manager. So he often goes to work when he's sick or goes back to work when he's still on the mend. When working sick day after day, an illness which would usually last for several days can end up lasting several weeks as complications set in. I feel angry that businesses are making money on the backs of sick employees and that you are bringing a bill forward that would allow corporations to treat St. Paul workers this way. It's not right that people should have to choose between getting better and getting by. Because the people of St. Paul fought for sick time, my son and 72,000, I think you remember that number now, but it's a lot of people, 72,000 other St. Paul workers won the right to paid sick time. And because of our leadership, everyone in St. Paul will have access to sick time starting July 1st. House File 600 is a violation of their rights and a violation of local democracy. My faith values say that no one should be left behind and that everyone deserves to be treated with dignity and respect. We look to you, the state legislature, to serve the common good and to uphold our democracy. Today, I urge you, don't take my son's sick time and don't let corporate interests take away Minnesotans' ability to determine what is best for their town or city. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. So now we're going to go back to, and thank you again, Mr. Ladell, for your help in assisting that. It's greatly appreciated. So now we're going to go back to the list. Tom Hackbarth. Is that how you say it, sir? Is that the name?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, members. My name is Tom Hackbarth. I represent the Bowling Proprietors Association of Minnesota, and I'm here in support of House File 600, the uniform statewide labor standard. We are a group of small businesses across the state of Minnesota, many that are located in the city of Minneapolis and in the metropolitan area and throughout the state of Minnesota. We do not support a patchwork of different laws for labor standards, and we are behind this bill 100%. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much for your testimony. Is the committee page present? Is Sam here? Where are you at, Sam? You want to bring the sign-up sheet down here just so let everyone see you again, because some people may have came. Again, if you have not signed up in advance of to testify in the committee and you wish to testify, that is Sam, the loyal committee page right there. Raise your hand, Sam. Okay. Please get your name on the sign-up list so that we know. So right now we're still taking those. I'm going to try to – is Lisa Stratton here? Why don't you come on down, Lisa? We'll take you next. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members of the committee. My name is Lisa Stratton, and I'm the executive director. Oh, I'm sorry. I demoted myself this year. I am senior counsel for Gender Justice, a nonprofit organization that works for women's rights and LGBTQ rights. We are based in St. Paul, and I also served on the St. Paul task force, like Ms. Roach and others who have testified. So I have now experienced local democracy at work very directly, and I have to say, it's an emotional feeling to work as hard as we did after meeting, you know, not being home for your children, sitting around with 30 of your fellow citizens, debating whether to have earned sick and safe time in the city of St. Paul, and having a wonderful, vibrant exchange with people from all different viewpoints. Very large corporations were represented. Very small businesses were represented. I think there were five different small restaurant owners on that task force. And we all worked through it, and we came up with what we thought would be best. It was vetted by the city council. I testified at the city council about the impact it would have on women in particular to have some earned sick and safe time for domestic violence reasons and to care for children, where I think I was just here yesterday saying that women disproportionately take that role in our families and our society. And it was a beautiful thing to see it pass, as others have said, democracy at work. And it's really quite an emotional feeling to see this bill come and realize that all that work will be completely wiped out. And not just all that work, but any future work that any other task force or committee or group of citizens, the city of St. Paul might decide to convene and seek recommendations from and act upon their recommendations. It could never happen again, basically, for any of the broad areas of regulation that are named in this bill. And I testified against a similar bill in 2015, and there have been some changes here, but there is still a huge catch-all provision. This is the other side. My other hat is as an employment lawyer. There is a huge catch-all provision that prevents the adoption of any new rules that would provide an employee a particular benefit, term of employment, or working condition. The way I read this, and the effective date, it only applies to ordinances or laws, regulations enacted last year, from January 1st, 2016 forward. So we have absolutely no rationale that I can see in this bill that has any policy reason other than wanting to stop the work of, you know, citizens like me who served for a democratic process, for allowing all the laws that existed before January 1st, 2016 that the cities have adopted in their wisdom and under the powers that you have delegated to them will all persist. But any that passed after January 1st, 2016 and forward, as I read this, will no longer be in effect and can no other future law could ever be passed. The terms here, the catch-all term is extremely broad, and I am again concerned as an employment lawyer that we don't know what this might affect. I could see it affecting the word working condition under the blunt instrument of this catch-all exception could end up affecting worker safety regulations. They could never change into the future. Human rights regulations or ordinances could never change into the future. And it's my view, and as one of the local folks who worked hard on a local ordinance, that that is not a good thing for our society or our democracy. I don't think it helps any of the policies that I think the committee, in recognizing need for paid family leave and discussing some of these other workplace policies, I don't think intends to bring progress to a halt. And I'd encourage you to not to pass this bill and to allow cities and localities and all the wonderful people in this room to continue to be able to act when their local localities ask them to.
Thank you. Ken Rockler. Welcome to the committee, sir. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Chairman Garofalo, members of the committee, Ken Rockler on behalf of the Tavern League, also a long history in the restaurant business. Two basic facets I'd like to testify on very quickly. I apologize, I wasn't here in the beginning, so I may be redundant, but this is being portrayed as corporations against individual workers, and that's really not the case. I was before this committee or others 2 years ago. I actually testified in favor of a raise in the minimum wage. My history, when we had four restaurants, one in Minnetonka, one in Minneapolis, one in Brooklyn Center, and one in Long Lake, beginning in 1976, there were no laws, but we gave health insurance to our employees at a time when that was very unusual in the restaurant business. We had paid vacation. But what you got going right here now is you've got a patchwork that would be very difficult just in terms of the bookkeeping alone, let alone the hardship it may produce. I'm here to support House File 600, and it's not a matter of being heartless. Again, I've testified in favor of minimum wage before. We're just concerned about the difficulty this would place. I would stand for any questions about our past history, but again, I strongly support House File 600.
Thank you for your testimony. Next is Tim Maluli. Did I say that right? Mr. Maluli, did you just walk in from the outside? That's incredibly good timing.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah, I don't.
I almost didn't hear you. I apologize.
Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you. My name is Tim or Timothy Maluli, spelled M-A-L-O-O-L-Y. Thank you for seeing me. I'm here today to testify in favor of the measure, SF 600. I am a business owner, Minneapolis-based business owner. I own and operate three small businesses. One business is 32 years old, two other businesses are 25 years old. The businesses are members of the greater green industry. I am also here representing the Minnesota Nursery and Landscape Association, which is the statewide business association representing the greater green industry, what we would know of as garden centers, growers, landscapers, stewards, landscape irrigation contractors, and service providers. And as such, I'd like to express, again, as I mentioned, our favorable approach and my personal support as well of the measure. The concept of labor standards, should they exist and should they need to be mandated from time to time by governmental agencies, should center at the state level to protect and preserve the interests of all parties and all entities over the long run as regards employment practices, fairness, and the ability for businesses to conduct commerce throughout the state and maintain records properly and lawfully within the constraints or the confines of what they must do. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you very much for your testimony, sir.
Thank you.
Next, Ann Finn from the League of Minnesota Cities. And Ms. Finn, so we have a letter from the League of Minnesota Cities that's been passed out. Do you want to enter this into the record, or do you wish to testify as well? Just enter it to use this then? Okay, thank you. Chris Conry. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Good evening. Chairman Garofalo and members of the committee, my name is Chris Conry. I'm the Strategic Campaigns Director at Take Action Minnesota. We're a grassroots organization that advocates for racial, gender, and social justice at the local, state, and federal level. I'm here today to speak in opposition to House File 600. We're opposed to this bill for many of the reasons that you've already heard, that it's bad for working families, it's bad for racial equity, it's bad for local elected officials, but it's also bad for local citizens who want to participate in their democracy. Our organization was one of many that participated in passing the Earn Sick and Safe Time ordinances in the Twin Cities. That process was, in one way, very much like what you'd expect. There were hearings and ordinance language and votes, and in the other ways, the process was kind of extraordinary. Local chambers, nurses, small business owners, low-wage workers, academics, unions, moms and dads all had to sit down and look each other in the eye and try to agree to something. And no one got exactly what they wanted, but everyone did get a chance to participate. And we need more ways to participate. We need more spaces where people who disagree with each other have to sit down and talk. Our cities and towns and counties need to be one of those places. So many of you and many of your colleagues started your public service on a school board or at a city council or on a county board. And you know the value of the work that local governments do. And you know what passion that work can inspire in local citizens. So please keep this law as it is, and please keep the doors of local government open to regular people.
Thank you for your testimony. Just for scheduling purposes, members, what we'll do is we'll take a couple more testifiers. We'll recess to grab a quick dinner, and then we'll come back and we'll reconvene and continue with public testimony. So the next person on the list is Jill Larson, Representative Mahoney.
Do you have a sense of how long you're going to recess for dinner? Is it 10 minutes? Is it a half an hour? Preferably, if we have this many testifiers or this many citizens, we probably don't want to keep them waiting too long.
Absolutely. I would agree. I would say ballpark would be 35 to 40 minutes, Representative Mahoney.
Well, how about 20? I'm a fast eater.
We'll let you come down and reconvene. We'll do that.
Oh, right.
For the record. No, so I think that'd be a good ballpark, 35, 40 minutes approximately for the recess. Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members. My name is Jill Larson. I'm here representing the Minnesota Business Partnership. We represent about 120 of Minnesota's largest employers, most of whom are headquartered here in Minnesota. I'm here tonight to give our support for House File 600. As you've heard from other testifiers earlier tonight, we are concerned about this growing trend of local workplace mandates. This patchwork of rules is causing a lot of headaches for even large businesses in addition to the small and mid-sized ones you've heard from earlier. Most of our members already offer pretty robust benefits to their employees, including things like paid sick leave and paid family leave. So the issue for us is not the benefit. The issue is that we represent employers that have employees and facilities not only all over the state, but all over the country and the world. And for employers like ours, even those that have fairly sophisticated HR systems, I mean, these are people that have dedicated HR staffs, it is becoming increasingly challenging to comply with these new local mandates. It just is an administrative nightmare. If you think about, you've got an employee who might be here part-time in a different state another time. You've got people that might work from home that are in a community that has an ordinance, but the business is located in a community that doesn't. And so when you combine these local variations with an increasingly mobile workforce, you get a recipe for a really complicated and difficult, burdensome compliance process. Right. And so what ends up happening is, even for these large employers, they have to do these manual overrides of their HR systems. Right. And that can result not only in administrative burden, but it can result in just honest human error. Somebody makes a mistake. And what can happen then is there's penalties that are imposed and lawsuits that can be filed. So we strongly support this bill. Thank you for the opportunity to testify.
Thank you for your testimony. Adam Hansen.
Sounds like we should have a United Nations standard, Mr. Chair.
is a Frank Brown here? Frank Brown? No? Not here? Okay. Is a Isaac Heil or Heil? Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the committee. My name is Adam Hansen. I'm with the Associated Builders and Contractors of Minnesota. We represent over 300 merit shop construction companies throughout the state. These companies employ over 22,000 high-quality, high-trained, multi-skilled craft professionals. Our contractor members across the state pay their employees competitively. They pay them based on merit, based on experience, and by job performance. They also offer competitive benefit packages to match the needs of an ever-changing and in-demand workforce. ABC supports House File 600. We support the bill because we are seeing cities claiming the authority to tell construction companies who work on private jobs to pay prevailing wage or provide a benefit package. These one-size benefit packages, as we've heard before, are tough to implement and tough to work with. Now, these cities are offering a way to buy these benefit packages out by paying a prevailing wage, which doesn't offer the benefits of the ordinances in the first place. Prevailing wage laws are a relic of the early 1900s. They were never designed to apply to private work like these ordinances are requiring, and they act as an artificial fence to limit competition. This is exactly what will happen without House File 600. Passing this bill will ensure that contractors throughout the state can bid competitively, provide flexible, innovative, and competitive benefits and wage packages like they already do, and also have the confidence in knowing that a patchwork of unworkable and costly mandates won't affect where they bid, how they bid, and where they work. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you for your testimony.
Mr. Chair, clarifying question
on
this. Does this preempt prevailing wage laws?
Mr. Chairman, or Mr. Chair, Representative, bad habits. No, it doesn't, so.
So. The testifier said it did, so I'm confused.
Okay, well, there's questions and
I'll be able to answer questions.
So. Well, I'd love him to come back later to explain why it preempts prevailing wage laws.
Certainly his choice. The final testifier is Teresa Cuevas. How do you say that? Welcome to the committee. Please state your name for the record and proceed with your testimony.
That's good. Thank you, Mr. Chair and committee members. My name is Teresa Cuevas. I work for the Minnesota Bankers Association. We represent 95% of the banks in the state. We have about 370 banks that have presence in the state. That's over about 2,000 branches throughout the state and 50,000 employees. We just wanted to come and support House File 600, and we prefer to have a statewide standard on labor regulations and not a city-by-city patchwork. We do have banks that have obviously multi-branches, and they do work throughout the different cities, and so it's much easier if we just have one standard. Thank you.
Well, thank you.
We bailed you out.
With this, members, we'll be recessed.
Can we move a motion on that and take a roll call on it?
The move to recess the call of the chair?
Yeah, I think we should stay in.
Okay. The roll call has been requested on the move to recess to the call of the chair. The committee legislative assistant will call the roll. I didn't get to specify a time, but that's okay.
Garofalo.
Yes.
Neuberger.
Aye.
Mahoney.
No.
Clark.
No.
Wagenius.
No.
Anderson.
Yes.
Barr.
Yes.
Baker.
Aye.
Dabney.
No.
Fabian.
Yes.
Howe.
Yay.
Lehman.
Yes.
McQuaid.
No.
Metza.
No.
Moran.
No.
O'Neill.
Yes.
Rarick.
Yes.
Scott.
Yes.
Sundin.
No.
Thiessen.
No.
Vogel.
Yes.
West.
Yes.
There are 13 ayes and 9 nays. The motion to recess to the call of the chair is successful. Members will 6:01 right now, so plan on about 6:40 to 6:45 is when I expect we'll be back. We are recessed to the call of the chair.